All right, so let's wrap all this up by summarizing what we've learned about processes and threads and how they differ, and then kind of put all of this into context with the things that we've studied this semester and the things that you will be studying in some of the remaining courses that you might take in the system sequence. So a process is a currently executing program, whereas a thread is a unit of execution or a logical flow. Processes have private code and state, and threads have private program counters, registers, condition codes, stack. So some differences are that they are created differently. So processes are created via the fork system call, and the parent and the child continue from the same call site. Threads are created via library call, so for instance, pthread create, and the child runs a separate routine, and so the parent and child have differing behaviors in that respect. The primary difference that we're concerned about in this course is the notion of a private versus a shared address space, though. So if you have multiple processes running on a computer, even if they were forked from the same process, they have their own private address space. And so the things in that address space are not going to be visible to other processes. However, all the threads that are in a single process are able to see this that process's address space, and all the data is shared with other threads, at least all the data that is accessible to those threads. So both of these have advantages. So processes impose more isolation, which means that they're, you know, safer. They don't have as many, there isn't as much opportunity for things like data races. You don't need to use mutual exclusion explicitly when you're trying to access shared resources, because there are just, you know, fewer shared resources. You may have to do something when you access files that are shared, but otherwise you are working with separate address spaces. The advantages of threads are that you get faster context switching. Thread context switching is faster than process context switching. And there are more shared resources, so you may be able to do more efficient communication between threads than between processes. Okay, so let's take a quick step back and just look at the history of parallel systems and think about what we've studied and where we may go next, and some things that may be covered in other classes. And this is also a wrap of our discussion of operating systems, because we'll see how operating systems have evolved over the years. So most of the first computers were uniprogramming or batch computers. This was back in the 1950s and before. And basically only one process ran at a time, and it had complete control over the CPU. And there really wasn't that much going on in terms of the operating system. In some computers, the operating system was literally a person who fed punch cards into the machine and then read off the results. And so if there was an operating system, it was mostly just a piece of software that handled launching a program. And this is basically the world that we have studied this semester. I know that we've talked about it in the context of modern CPUs, but you know, until we've really gotten to these last couple of weeks where we've talked about processes and threads, we really haven't talked too much about any sort of situation where you have more than one program running on a CPU. So the next sort of era in terms of parallel systems is the era of multi-programming or multitasking or time sharing. And this was predominant in the 1960s. And this was characterized by having multiple processes taking turns to run on a single CPU. So there was still only one CPU in the system, but you were able to run multiple programs at the same time because you would switch back and forth between them, and everybody got a little bit of a share of the time of the system. That's why it was called time sharing. So this was nice because it enabled greater utilization of the system. So many people could be using it at the same time, and you would have a lower response time because if you had a short program, you don't have to wait in the queue. It can just run and it'll finish faster than if you had to wait for other programs to finish first. But of course, this introduced the need for the operating systems to become more sophisticated, because they have to handle the scheduling and the context switching between all the processes that were running on the computer. So we've already talked about this a little bit in this course, if you take 450, which is our course on operating systems, you'll dive into this and talk about how this is implemented in much greater detail. Then we moved to the era of multiprocessing in the 1970s and beyond, where we have multiple cores in a single computer. Multiple cores inside a CPU, multiple CPUs inside the same computer. And so now you have multiple programs that are running at the exact same time. They're not just time sharing. They are actually running simultaneously on different hardware. And so this increased throughput even more and increased the parallelism. But of course, this increased the complexity of all the things that the operating system had to do. And it increased the complexity of communication between all of these processes that are running. And so you'll spend a lot of time in the next course, CS361, talking about the complexities that are introduced by multiprocessing. You'll also see this again if you take 450 in the context of operating systems, and you'll see this again in 470 in the context of more massively parallelized and distributed computing. And finally, we are now sort of in the era of distributed processing, which sort of began in the 1980s and onward, where now we even have multiple computers working together to solve the same problem. So we'll have clusters of computers that are all communicating over some sort of shared network. And these kinds of systems, it turns out, can scale quite well, quite massively. And so you can build, you know, thousands and thousands of nodes in the same cluster that may have millions of individual CPUs or cores. And it requires quite sophisticated software in order to coordinate systems like this in order to solve a problem efficiently. And it turns out that in many cases, an operating system is no longer even sufficient. And you need some other kind of middleware, like a job scheduling system, to coordinate jobs running across multiple computers. You'll talk about this a little bit in 361, but this is sort of the primary domain of 470, which is parallel and distributed systems, where you'll talk about this and you will work with a small cluster that we have to write programs that will run across that cluster and take advantage of it. You may also talk a little bit about this sort of thing if you take our networks course, which isn't listed here, but that's another advanced systems elective. You may also, if you take the architecture course, you may talk about the low-level details about how some of these systems differ from each other, and about how you can build these systems up from the core from smaller components, the way that we did to a lesser extent in our section on CPU architecture. So that wraps up our discussion of operating systems by extension, our discussion this semester. So I hope that this has been a good semester for you, and I hope that it has given you a really solid groundwork for the rest of the courses that you take in the systems curriculum here at James Madison University.